Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of 2024 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have apologies from Paul O'Kane and Megan Gallagher. Our first agenda item is the Disability Commissioner Scotland Bill evidence session, and I would invite Maggie Chapman to declare an interest, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I probably should have done this at the start of this inquiry, but just so folks are aware, I used to work for a vision impairment organisation of which RNIB Scotland was a member, the Scottish Council on Vision Impairment, but that was about a decade ago.
Okay. Thank you for that, Maggie. Now we will move on to take evidence on our Disability Commissioner Scotland Bill, and I'll refer members to papers 1 and 2. And I'll welcome to the meeting our witnesses. We have Kirsty Henderson, Policy Officer, RNIB Scotland, Amy Dalrymple, Associate Director of Policy and Public Affairs, Marie Curie Scotland, Thomas Gerrard, Bid Writer, Deaf Action, and Richard Mead, Director, Carers Scotland and Carers Northern Ireland. You're all very welcome and thank you for attending this morning. There is an opportunity for brief opening statements before we move into questions from the committee. Can I start, please, with Kirsty Henderson?
Hi there. Good morning, everyone, and thank you. Unfortunately, James Adams isn't here due to being unwell. So RNIB Scotland, we originally responded to Jeremy Balfour, MSP, proposal for the Disability Commissioner in 2022, and we recently submitted our own call for views. RNIB Scotland works on behalf of all people with sight loss in Scotland. We support them to live full and independent lives, campaigning for their rights and to highlight the physical, emotional and financial challenges of living with a visual impairment. We have been very supportive and are still supportive on the creation of a Disability Commissioner for Scotland. We obviously work closely with the sight loss sector in Scotland. We all play a very unique role in that sector to reflect the diverse needs of blind and partially sighted people. And, yeah, interested to hear more as to how the Disability Commissioner could represent the needs of people with visual impairments in Scotland also.
Okay, thank you. We'll now move on to Amy Dalrymple, please.
Thank you, Karen, and thank you to the committee for inviting Marie Curie to give evidence this morning. Marie Curie is the largest charitable provider of palliative and end-of-life care for adults. We provide care for people across Scotland, and last year we cared for roughly 8,000 people at the end of their lives, in the last year of their lives. Our interest in this is the fact that we know that too many people with a terminal illness are not able to access the care and support that they need at the end of their lives. And we welcome the intent of this proposal on the basis that it creates an accountability mechanism to make sure that people who are dying and their families get the care and support they need. People with a terminal illness are defined as having a disability under the Equality Act, and so would, according to this proposal, come within the scope of the Disability Commissioner. At the moment, too many people who are dying don't get the care and support they need. It leads to suffering for them, for their families, and it leads to system pressure, which is avoidable. Unmet need for palliative care leads to significantly poorer physical and mental health and financial outcomes as well. So we welcome the intent of this proposal. We are really interested in the discussion that the committee's had around how it fits, because what we're interested in is accountability and outcomes, and it fits quite well, and it fits with our campaign for a right to palliative care as well, and how the rights landscape and the commissioner landscape interact with each other is, I think, important to pin down, to clarify. What people need is clarity, what people need is coherence, and what people need is the ability to make sure that they can get the support, the care, the participation in society that they should have.
Thank you, Amy. Now move on to Thomas, please.
Hello, thank you. Thank you very much for inviting Deaf Action to the committee today. I am Thomas Gerard. I'm a bid writer representing Deaf Action Today. I am a deaf BSL user myself. That's my BSL interpreter over there in the room with me. So Deaf Action are a charity organisation for the deaf based in Scotland and south of England. We provide services across nearly all sectors in health through social care, or support and education through our youth service, or a cultural section with our Edinburgh Deaf Festival every year. We recognise that there are barriers facing deaf people every day in their lives in all sectors, health, education, and the social aspects of their lives. So we are very interested to see how the Disability Commissioner will work in the current landscape of the Scottish Government. We have recently been involved with the BSL National Plan as a key stakeholder, and we are interested in seeing how that will provide intersectionality with that BSL National Plan, and also across all these other organisations here with us today. So thank you.
Thank you. Richard Mead, please.
Good morning, Convener, and thank you for inviting Carers Scotland to give evidence today. Carers Scotland is a charity that supports Scotland's 800,000 unpaid carers, and we are a charity that campaigns and lobbies for change, as well as providing direct support to carers. And we're a membership organisation with nearly 3,000 unpaid carers that are members in Scotland. And we support the proposed legislation. We see a need for a disability commissioner in Scotland to make sure that disabled people are prioritised and put on a level playing field with the rest of Scotland. And far too often, those living with disabilities do not get the support they need to enjoy the same opportunities available to those without disabilities. However, we believe the commissioner role should have a supplementary remit in relation to unpaid carers. An unpaid carer is a family member, partner, friend or neighbour who helps a person with daily activities that they would not be able to manage if they did not have that help. And that could be a partner, a family member or friend who has a long-term or terminal illness, someone who is disabled or has a mental health condition, is affected by addiction or needs extra help as they grow older. And as I said, there are approximately 800,000 people in Scotland providing such unpaid care. And the Scottish Parliament has estimated that it would cost £13.1 billion to replace the care that they currently provide. And many of those people living with disabilities are supported by unpaid carers. And this support is crucial and can often be the difference between a person being able to stay at home rather than in another care setting. And it's crucial in supporting people to live as independently as possible. And the lives of disabled people and unpaid carers are often closely linked, and decisions made by public bodies and service providers on a whole range of issues that affect disabled people can often have a direct impact on the lives of carers, and indeed vice versa. In order to support the cared for person, it is crucial to ensure that unpaid carers are also supported. And so by extension, a proposed disability commissioner should have a remit that considers unpaid carers and how to promote and safeguard their rights, as if unmet, these often have a direct consequence on the person that they care for people with disabilities. For example, the right to be involved in the discharge planning of a person from hospital. 60% of unpaid carers told us that they were not informed and not involved in decisions about discharge, yet under the requirements of the Carers Scotland Act 2016, they should be. And when this does not happen, it can have huge consequences for the person they're caring for and their ability to be at home or in the community, often leading to readmissions or actually a person being moved to another care setting, such as a care home. So many unpaid carers also have a disability in their own right. However, this can often be hidden from sight, as the focus of both services, society, and indeed the unpaid carer themselves remains on the person they are caring for. Our State of Caring survey, which last year had over 1,700 carers participate in Scotland, found that 29% of those are carers also consider themselves to have a disability. And that's slightly higher than the rest of the UK in terms of an average. So by having a specific remit for unpaid carers, we hope that there will be greater opportunities for unpaid carers with disabilities to access services, but also perhaps to help unpaid carers realise that they are carers and get the support they need. Ultimately, we believe that a disability commissioner with a remit that includes unpaid care will play an important role in exposing bad practice, failure to access rights and services, and shine a light on those ongoing challenges and hopefully lead to positive change. People are tired of failing to get the support they need and deserve by a right. They are tired of being marginalised, and they are fed up of feeling left behind, which so many do, and they feel forgotten about. So we should support any steps that might improve this for them. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you all very much. We will now move on to questions from members of the committee. I'm going to firstly kick off, and I will be doing mine in sign language, and then I will speak. So my first question, I want to ask, what do you think about the bill and the main points? Like, what do you think? And I'll ask Thomas first, please.
So, thank you for your question, Karen. Deaf Action is in support of this bill, as we are very keen to see a voice for the disabled people and people with mental health issues and all the rest of it across in Scottish Government. Our experience has been working with Scottish Government with the BSL National Plan is that we feel that there is a kind of a systemic issue across policy making, whereas there are no true representatives of the voices that are being represented in such policies and bills. So, for example, a hearing person may be dictating policy in education for a deaf person, of which they might have no real or lived experience, and it will be operating off the numbers, you know, or statistics off the page, which may or may not be the right thing, but as we all know, what's on paper does not reflect what happens in everyday life. And so we feel the Disability Commissioning Bill is a real step forward to have that voice present in the room that is truly reflective of our experiences of the deaf community. So that's how we feel.
Thank you, Thomas. So I spoke and signed a bit there, but just for clarity, what are your views on the bill, and do you support the general principles of the bill? And I'll come to Amy, please.
Thanks very much. If this doesn't happen, then something else needs to happen in order to realise the intent that is behind this proposal. Disabled people are so are marginalised across. I mean, from our point of view, across health, across social care, we see it. But also in education, in access to justice, in ability to just participate socially. If you walk around Edinburgh, you will see how inaccessible it is for people with a physical disability, and you have the and people with learning disabilities, we know and we can tell from our work in Marie Curie, experience huge barriers to being able to get the care that they need. Cognitive disability also creates problems in terms of being recognised as a comorbidity, being recognised as a disability, for people being able to access the care they need when they need it, and being able to advocate for their own rights as well. So we absolutely recognise the need for this bill, for why the Disability Commissioner is proposed, and as the proposal on the table, we would support it. The only other option, I would say, would be to have a very comprehensive look at the, as I know that, you know, kind of is being looked at by parliamentary committees at the moment, at the commissioner landscape, to make sure that that the existing commissioners, or a rejigged structure of commissioners, are specifically championing the rights of people with disabilities, because there is that need for that voice for disabled people, for that champion for the disabled people, with that focus on disabled people, due to how marginalised they are from so many aspects of life in Scotland.
Thank you, Amy. Kirsty, please.
RNIB Scotland, we are supportive of the bill and the proposals, including the ability for the Commissioner to be a champion for disabled people. We note that within the details of the bill, there's quite a bit of detail on investigatory powers, where the Commissioner could potentially take on individual as well as general investigations. we also believe that, you know, the Disability Commissioner would have an important role in unifying the voice of disabled people from various impairment groups, as well as the kind of important role that disabled people's organisations play in protecting and raising awareness of the rights of disabled people. Our concern, I suppose, is that the current landscape is cluttered, has already been raised a few times in evidence by previous panels. And I think it's about the fact that there's potentially going to be more commissioners created in the political landscape in Scotland, and that could create quite a complex, cluttered landscape for individual disabled people to try and navigate. And I think from our point of view, representing blind and partially sighted people, we're already aware of the barriers that they face in many aspects of day-to-day life, one crucial one being around accessible information and not being able to access information in a format that is accessible to them. I suppose and I don't know if I'm jumping ahead as far as the questions that may be coming, I think a challenge for the Disability Commissioner will be justifying what matters it takes on and what matters it doesn't. Building trust amongst disabled people is crucial for it to realise its role representing the diverse needs of disabled people, and justifying whether it steps in or not, having accountability mechanisms so that people know why it's taking on the investigations it may take on. That's really important as well. So,
thank you, Kirsty. Richard, please.
Firstly, agree with the rest of the panel and what they've said so far. Carer Scotland, we do support the general principles of the bill. I think there is a need for the role of a disability commissioner and its ability to hopefully expose some of the bad practice that we're seeing, actually shine a light on the inequities and inequalities that are faced by people with disabilities, and create an opportunity to see positive change. As I said in my statement, we definitely feel that there is a need to look at how we can include unpaid carers as part of that, because they're often so intrinsically linked in supporting people with disabilities, and we hear all the time the impact on families and people who do not get access to their rights, they do not get access to the services that they need, and the impact that has on their quality of life, not just in the short term while they're not getting the support they need, but actually long term and well into the future.
Thank you, Richard. My second question. And I'm asking, the people fed back that there was strong support for the bill. Why do you think that is the case? And I'll go to Thomas.
Thank you for your question, Karen. I'm sure I'm not the only person on the panel who believes that we are seeing disabled people living their everyday lives. It is a constant struggle. You know, there are barriers to communication, information not being in the correct format. For example, deaf people are leaving school a full grade behind their hearing peers at the age of 16. And if this has a massive knock-on effect on levels of unemployment that pervades the deaf community. So an opportunity for the disabled community to have a voice in government is something that will hugely benefit the community, and the level of support will be from the level of frustration of not having a seat at the table in committees or meetings, or having a correct representative, or if you have an issue, there's no clear point of contact, who to kind of report this issue to, and who to feedback, and who can make these decisions that will directly influence these lives of disabled people. So that's why I think there are positive level of support for this bill.
Okay. Thank you, Thomas. Amy?
The strong support for the bill, I would suggest that we've seen from organisations like ours that you'll have heard from disabled people themselves as well, is predicated on the fact that there is a frustration, I think, that the existing framework has not led to change and improvement in terms of disabled people's participation in the workforce, in terms of disabled people's representation, I don't know how many people, but you have heard from more people without a disability than with a disability about a disability commissioner bill on your panels, and that's to do with structures and with organisations, and the fact that this is about structures as much as it's about as much as it's about anything else. I understand, but it's symptomatic of the fact that there are very low levels of participation from disabled people in many decision-making structures, which as a policy person would suggest is one of the things that leads to a low level of service provision, of people not being able to get the services and support they need, not being able to get the accommodations they need in order to be able to access services, in order to be able to participate in the workplace, and therefore you end up with higher levels of poverty amongst disabled people, you end up with an inability to access care and support, and you end up with the issues that Rich has described around carers, you end up with the issues that Thomas has correctly described around access to education and participation and how decisions are made. And from Marie Curie's point of view, you end up with higher levels of need but lower levels of service access for people being able to get the care and support that they actually need.
Thank you, Amy. Kirsty?
Yeah, just to echo the points that Amy was making there, I think there's strong support for the Disability Commissioner because disabled people across the board have faced massive challenges over the last few years. There's no taking away from the fact that the pandemic brought about a number of challenges. Looking at the experience of blind and partially sighted people, many social distancing measures were inaccessible to them. There were changes to streets and environments, again, which were primarily communicated through visual means, so these were inaccessible to them. An RNIB survey reported that 2/3 of blind and partially sighted people now feel less independent than they did prior to the pandemic. We've heard numerous stories of care packages just vanishing basically overnight during the pandemic. And as Amy touched on there, to then have to face a cost of living crisis where the cost of the everyday essentials is going up, has presented more challenges for blind and partially sighted people. The ability to purchase essential equipment or aids or adaptations to enable them to live independently, they've had to limit expenses on those types of aids also. And I think just generally the support for disabled people in Scotland, whether it's through health, social care, it's a very mixed picture. And often what you can access and the support you can get is dependent on the services available in your area. And that's a very mixed picture. We are currently working on raising awareness of the need for visual rehabilitation as a example of how when a person's first diagnosed with a visual impairment, accessing visual rehabilitation is crucial for them to be able to adapt to living at home and also gain skills to be able to get out in the community to navigate successfully. But there's such in some cases a backlog, but also just a dearth of service provision in that area. So I think that's really kind of why there's overall issues about why there is a need and why there is strong support for a disability commissioner.
Thank you, Kirsty. Richard, please.
Yeah, I think, again, agreeing with the rest of the panel, but I think there is a feeling of amongst the population increasingly marginalised and removed from opportunities that everyone should be able to enjoy or expect as part of what society offers, and whether that's access to education, to employment, to health and social care services, I think people are not enjoying those opportunities, and they have got worse. And I think colleagues have mentioned the pandemic. Many services have not returned to pre-pandemic level, and it's disproportionately impacting on those people with disabilities, and for us, by extension, often their carers. And people are often not getting, even if they are getting some service support, it's not as person-centred, it doesn't meet their needs. So I think people are feeling that increased marginalisation from support and society that they should be getting, and that has huge impact on everything from health and well-being to financial security and poverty. And even within the unpaid population, unpaid caring population, which is, again, exposes massive levels of inequity and inequality when compared to non-carers. Even within that population, those carers that have disabilities report even more or greater levels of inequality and inequity. So even in those marginalised communities and those that are more vulnerable, it's disproportionately impacting on people with disabilities. So I think that explains exactly why there is a clamour for something like this.
Thank you, Richard. We'll now move on to questions from Maggie Chapman, please.
Thank you, Karen, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for your comments so far. I want to ask some questions around the cluttered landscape, the complexity and the potential for duplication that Amy and Kirsty, you both raised specifically, but everybody has touched on. It's been suggested to us that a new disability commissioner might complicate and fragment an already cluttered and complex landscape of human rights commissioners, but also that this possibility could be overcome by close working together, by memorandums of understanding, that kind of thing. And I just wondered what your views on this are. Amy, as you raised this earlier, could you comment on that?
Thank you. I sort of can't comment hugely without mentioning the other proposals there are on the table. You know, there's a pre-legislative consultation on Learning Disability and Neurodiversity Bill, which includes a proposal for a commission or a commissioner as well, and options for that, which would overlap with this. And of course, we already have the EHRC, the SHRC, and a children's commissioner. And, you know, kind of there's some discussion as to, you know, kind of what would the scope of the disability commissioner be, and would it include children? The reason that, you know, kind of Karen's question previously about there being such strong support for this bill is that the existing commissioner landscape is not working for disabled people. So if it's not working, then it needs to be changed in order to make sure that disabled people can have the accountability that is required, because a commissioner is, of course, about making sure that existing rights and existing legislation that is meant to work for disabled people is actually happening, be that the Equalities Act, the Human Rights Act, hopefully the UNCRPD, the UN Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities, shouldn't use the acronyms, will be incorporated at some point soon into Scottish law as well. So it's about working with existing legislation, and therefore either the existing landscape needs to improve and get better, or this disability commissioner needs to, you know, be enacted. This proposal needs to be enacted, and a commissioner needs to be appointed, and they need to have appropriate powers, which I think important as well. There is, I don't think Marie Curie would support the appointment of a commissioner that was done in a tokenistic way, that was there to pay lip service to say, look, of course we support the enactment of these rights, without it having the teeth to actually do something. I think there's a problem with legislation. I could cite the the Patients' Rights Bill. I'm sure that Richard might talk about the Carers Act, that includes legislation that's meant to enable people to improve their lives, but doesn't actually have the mechanisms for impact. So support is conditional on it actually having some impact and being able to achieve what it's meant to achieve. In terms of the cluttered landscape there is, sorry to get back to your original question, I think you need to take all that into account when looking at it. And I think that a look at the landscape as a whole and how it's working is worth doing, and using that context to be able to describe why this is an important proposal and why this proposal is one that enjoys our support and the support of so many others.
Thanks, Amy. If I can just delve a little bit deeper there, you said it in your response there that obviously there's so many other commissioners, and there are also other public bodies, other statutory bodies, as well as legislation that is clearly failing. And I just wondered, you talked specifically about the need for mechanisms for impact, and I just wondered, what could you elaborate on that, and also what other kinds, why are all of these statutory bodies and commissioners and everything else failing? Is it purely about resource, or is there something else going on?
I wouldn't want to, you know, kind of speak for other bodies, but what we can see with the way that, you know, kind of what we've all described, what Kirsty and Thomas in particular have described so very eloquently about the way that, you know, kind of disabled people are living their lives in Scotland, and the lack of opportunity and the lack of ability to participate, and discrimination in services because people don't know what to do or find it too hard or too expensive. So we can see that there are problems. So it's due to it's being able to see that, which means that something else needs to happen. So is it about, you know, kind of whether it's about the resource, whether it's about the fact that they are able to pay attention to the needs of disabled people, or whether it's because their remits just are so broad that, you know, kind of the needs of people with disabled people are the needs of disabled people are, you know, kind of are just one of a number of sets of needs they have to respond to. I would not want to speak to them, but it's very clear that something needs to happen. I think we need to be very careful to make sure that the different proposals that there are, there's another proposal from an MSP around a commissioner for older people, for example, and older people are often the people with disabilities. Acquired disabilities come with age, so that there is a need to pay attention to structures and to structures as they're emerging. But there is also, on the face of it, you know, quite evidently, whether you look at statistics, whether you look at research, whether you look at people's experiences, a need for disabled people in Scotland to get a better deal.
Thanks, Amy. Richard, same kind of question about the cluttered landscape and duplication and all of that.
I'll have a little ramble about a couple of those issues. Okay. But firstly, I just wanted to come back to that. You talked about why is there this failure, perhaps, between policy intent and implementation, and whether it's resource, what are those issues? And I just thought it struck me that this is, again, there's a good example from the Carers Scotland Act, where you have, there is, within that legislation, the right, or all unpaid carers should be involved in the discharge planning of the person who's in hospital. And we found through our survey work that roughly 60% of carers are not involved in that and don't feel like they are involved in the discharge. And anecdotally, we hear some horrendous stories of people getting phone calls at 4 o'clock in the afternoon to say so-and-so has been discharged at 5 o'clock. And they've got a care package in place. They've not got the person that is their carer doesn't even necessarily live with them. And then all of a sudden they have to try and respond to that. And it can have catastrophic consequences. So why is that policy, which is great intent, and actually we should be involving unpaid carers as equal partners in care, but that is falling down? And partly, again, we hear because there is a lack of awareness around what those rights and what's in the legislation. So there's a training and development role there to ensure that practitioners understand and know what the legislation is and how they can best support that legislation and implement it. And again, just skewing to the left a little bit, that could be a role that a commissioner could play in terms of highlighting to practitioners those rights that people have. And then there is a resource issue. So in that example, again, we know that there's huge pressures on hospital beds and the need to get people through the system back home or into the community. So we do see decisions made, perhaps not with the best intention or without, certainly not in bad faith, but they are made that way, and as a consequence, that piece of legislation, that right that a carer has, is not met, and the carer becomes not involved, and the consequences can be, as I said, dire. So I think that is just a good example. There's a mixture of resources, awareness, there's a whole cluster of activity happening around rights and entitlements that defeat good policy or policy intent, which leads to that implementation gap. And I think that all needs to be looked at. And I absolutely think that a commissioner could potentially help in that role by highlighting that those sort of rights and then working with partners, whether it's organisations like us or with practitioners, to sort of try and address some of those gaps in policy and implementation. In question regarding the cluttered landscape, I think there's a fundamental question here is, why are we seeing this clamour for commissioners? It's because fundamentally people are feeling failed and marginalised and not getting the support that they need. And those policy intent, whether it's good or the gap is huge in lots of circumstances and in lots of groups. So I think it's a reflection of where we are right now, is that we're seeing these people feeling marginalised and they want a voice, they want a champion, they want to be heard. So they look at something like a commissioner as seeing that as an opportunity that might present that voice. And I think what we certainly can look at, and I think people have mentioned it in both this evidence session already and previous ones, is actually how we, those commissioners or that landscape works collectively and collaboratively, because I think there's certainly enough issues and challenges out there amongst communities to go round the commissioners, and actually by working collaboratively we might be able to actually shine a light on some of the intersectionality between these issues. We might be able to work and actually try and bring positive change in a whole range of different areas. So I think yes, the landscape might look cluttered, but I don't see that as being a barrier to delivering for the people that these commissioners and public bodies could represent, because I think there is an absolute need, because so many people are feeling marginalised, unheard, and are not getting the support that they need to live a quality of life that we should all expect.
That's a very helpful articulation of that. I suppose just a quick follow-up. In terms of the ease of navigation of the process, because one of the arguments for this commissioner and for others would be that there would be mechanisms of remedy or redress, and I suppose how would in your view how would you see us being able to lay out a clear pathway for people, given all of these different things that should be, as you say, working together collaboratively, but how would the person who needs redress and remedy navigate that?
So there needs to be clear and inclusive communication. Also, I think perhaps as part of those conversations, it's about how do you build a system that if somebody, as soon as somebody touches the system, reaches out for help, support, that actually everybody, there is a system that allows them to navigate that easily. And that actually will require buy-in from public bodies and commissioners, so that actually it's not a case of somebody gets in touch and you need to speak to so-and-so and they end up being referred away out of the problem, which we see quite a lot already. Actually, we need to have buy-in from all of those organisations that might be involved in this system that we're building, in the sense that actually as soon as somebody reaches out for help, that they're picked up and they're brought through that system, and it's easy for them to navigate. There's inclusive communication. They get to where they need to be in terms of whether it's a commissioner or a public body or whoever, so that they get that sense of being heard, but hopefully then even a satisfactory response to the complaint or the investigation or the need that they have.
Okay, thank you. Kirsty, if I could come to you, same kind of question around duplication, cluttered landscape, that kind of thing. I'll let you answer that first.
Yeah, I mean, I think Amy and Richard really articulately have explained the the problems that there are and the kind of, yeah, the accountability gap that currently exists. So when an individual does have a problem or a complaint, they're feeling that if it's not getting redressed and dealt with appropriately, then, you know, that's a problem. And I think there is a role for independent advocacy. I believe independent advocacy does play an important role to ensure that marginalised groups, particular groups, do have representation and do have support when it comes to seeking redress to an individual problem or a collective problem. But yeah, it is very difficult, and for blind and partially sighted people to try and navigate that when the information isn't necessarily always accessible, just it means that they kind of have to unpick and jump through potentially more hoops. I mean, we know that there's legislation there that backs up people's right to have information provided in accessible formats, but often we hear regularly that it's financial constraints. We can't necessarily always provide or fulfil requests for accessible information or to have services provided in a way that would meet a person's need. I think it's the difficulty with the current landscape as well, is when if commissioners aren't adequately resourced to be able to actually do the work that they're set out to do, that's in their sort of policy statement, then that can lead to a bit of disillusionment as well. I suppose I'm presenting more challenges here than solutions, but it's, yeah, I think health, social care, welfare, transport, all these systems operate differently, and whether you're a person with visual impairments or another condition impairment, it's really difficult to unpick all that and navigate your way through that and to try and find the accountability mechanism. So I think that if there was a disability commissioner established in Scotland, that could be one of its key roles, is to actually unpick that for disabled people from across the impairment spectrum. And if it's not working, then say to, you know, the accountability structure, whatever that is, why it's not working and what the recommendations could be to make it work better for people.
No, thank you. And in your earlier comments, you talked about the commissioner potentially having a unifying role, as that person, that advocate, that point of if not contact, at least that point of focus for both disabled people and others. I just wondered whether you think that there are any challenges thinking about how diverse disabled communities are, and even within the work that RNIB Scotland does, you know, the diversity within the people you support. How would you see one person being able to deal with that diversity, or one commissioner's office, because it wouldn't just be one person?
I think it's a really tricky question, unifying. I think there would be a role for unifying where there's shared experience of barriers and injustice, irrespective of what condition or impairment a person's affected by. They may have similar experience regardless of whether it's a mental health, physical impairment, sensory impairment. So I think there would be a role for the commissioner there to try and, you know, highlight where there are shared experiences in terms of trying to unify people. I think the commissioner's role in terms of recognising the various sectors that exist in Scotland, like the sight loss sector. We have Scottish Parliament cross-party group on visual impairment. So that, for example, is an effective vehicle, I think, for bringing the sight loss sector together to discuss and highlight some of the issues that blind and partially sighted people experience across Scotland. There may be other similar cross-party groups for other areas of work, so that may be one important role. I think just speaking to the various organisations that exist, disabled people's organisations, they do have a really key, crucial role. I don't think there's an easy answer to trying to unify. I think, it would require the Disability Commissioner in the early stages, if it was established, really reaching out to try and unpick, you know, who key players are, what's already out there. I think there could be a lot of work to just establish and work out memorandums of understanding and engagement before it could even look at actually getting involved with the day-to-day work of whether that's to be investigations and promoting and safeguarding rights of disabled people.
Thank you. And I suppose that the point you highlight there is, it's not easy. If it were easy, you would like to think we would have done it. You know, we would have sorted these issues by now. So it is going to be complex. Thanks for that, Thomas. If I can come to you now, when you spoke earlier, you talked about the need to have disabled people themselves very clearly involved, and thinking about how the landscape works, with duplication, with potential overlap, how is it currently for disabled people and the people that Deaf Action works with to navigate the existing landscape, even before we think about a new disability commissioner?
Thank you for your question. I'm not going to beat around the bush. The issue that we face here is a systemic one. You know, it's going to take years and decades of hard work from very talented people to kind of unravel this huge barrier. I'm not just speaking for deaf people here. That I'm speaking for disabled people across the entire spectrum. We all have a lot of overlap, but obviously my expertise is with deaf people. And it's like what Richard mentioned earlier, inclusive communication will be key, and that's just not kind of what's happening right now. It really feels like the landscape is kind of moving forward, without any consultation, without any valuable input from the community who experiences these issues on a daily basis with their lives, family, education, health, social care. The point I'm trying to make here is that while, yes, the landscape might be cluttered and this is seen as a negative for the Disability Commissioner, but I will come back and say it's cluttered because it's a systemic kind of issue. It's, the Disability Commissioner will go a long way to kind of start unravelling that for the disabled landscape. And by doing that, they will need to identify key, stakeholders in each of the, disability sectors. I can't even begin to count how many there is. I'm not going to even pretend that I know them all. To key stakeholders from each one, who is a voice for their community, who's agreed upon a voice for the community, to bring them into a room, or many different rooms, because there's so many different varieties, and just kind of feedback to the Disability Commissioner, and to be involved in a framework where they can kind of agree upon the general direction that Disability Commissioner can take. I know that's a big ask, but that is sort of what needs to happen. We need to unify behind a Disability Commissioner who has the power and the ability to take things forward and provide a voice for us in Scottish Parliament and Scottish government and across all policies. So that's my take. Okay.
Thanks, Thomas. Building on that, and in your opening statement, you talked about the importance of intersectionality with Deaf Action's work. And I wondered if you could just say a little bit more about how we can ensure that we embed intersectionality in how we think about the Disability Commissioner and the broader landscape.
Okay, that's a good question. I'm not sure if I have an answer for that. So, for example, deaf people, there's a lot of intersectionality as they age, they lose their hearing loss, or if they go overseas with the British Army, they might have experienced hearing loss as a result of things that happened over there, and they come back with additional physical disabilities and mental health, or you know, it's just deaf children born. Oh, children born with like meningitis or have complications at birth and they become, you know, deaf. And yeah, you know, there's lots of different crossovers, and we deal with that consistently. And the way that we kind of ensure that our services are most effective for those people is by having a good relationship with other organisations across our sector, such as, you know, Deafblind Scotland or Royal National Institute for the Deaf or British Deaf Association. Each of those organisations will have their own specialisation in what they do, as does Deaf Action. We have our specialisation in what we do. And it is the sharing of that knowledge, the sharing of the how we do things, and also being involved in the same kind of like policy making systems, such as a good example would be the BSL National Plan, which was published last year in November. We were part of a key stakeholder group that included, you know, Deafblind Scotland, the British Deaf Association, NCCS, National Deaf Children's Society, and we were able to kind of discuss and agree on the issues that would impact deaf community and how to address those intersectionalities and how that would be reflected in the plan. So that would be a good example, I think.
That's really helpful. I'll leave it there, Karen. Thank you.
Thank you, Maggie. We'll now move on to questions from Marie McNair, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. You've all sort of touched on the growing commissioner landscape in Scotland, and I wanted to ask what your specific views on the potential of having a disability commissioner as well as a learning disability and autism neurodiversion commissioner, and how the two of them might operate. I know you've kind of touched on it already, some of you, but I'll start with Amy, if you could expand a wee bit more on that.
Okay, thank you. On that question, I should declare an interest in that I'm also, aside from my work, I'm a member of the trustee of Down Syndrome Scotland, so have been working a little bit with them on that. I think there's this proposal is on the table. This proposal is in front of us for a disability commissioner. And the accountability mechanisms for the Learning Disability and Neurodiversity Bill are still being explored, and the two bits of legislation development probably need to be looked at together, and the scope needs to be really clear between the proposed commissioner under that legislation. Around the LDEM bill and the scope for this commissioner. Similarly, I was talking about the scope around age and the interaction with the current children's commissioner, which does extremely good work. There is also, I think you would need to look at the scope in terms of the EHRC, the Equality and Human Rights Commission, its responsibility specifically around reserved matters and the fact that there's maybe the gap that exists in terms of having that commissioner is maybe legislatively, even if not in action and impact terms, is around the rights in relation to devolved matters. So clarity around scope, I think, would be crucial. If that scope is clear, if the points of potential overlap are identified and a decision is made as to where responsibility lies, then that is then it is perfectly navigable. I will, in terms of a mechanism for how that works, and Richard talks about there needs to be a mechanism that means that as soon as you touch the system, you're directed to the right place. In terms of the, you know, dying and palliative care policy world, one of the bits of administration that really does work is tell us once, whereby when somebody dies, you mention that on the government and it goes to the DVLA and the passport office know and HMRC know and, you know, all the relevant bits of national government, including Scottish government and UK government, know that that person has died and the relevant administration kicks in. That mechanism shows that in that very important circumstance, that can be done. And the number of times I have had people ask me, well, if we can do it for that, why can't we do it for other things? And I would put that thought to yourselves in considering how a multi-commissioner landscape might work. So clarity of scope and get the administration right for the people, for the users, if you like, and it can be made to work for people.
Thank you. Anyone else want to share comments? Thomas?
Sorry, you lost me. What was the question again? Sorry.
It's just obviously just touching on the growing kind of commissioner landscape in Scotland. It's okay if you don't want to come in, it's no problem. Do you mean no pressure in like that?
No, at this point, I'm okay. Thank you.
No problem. Cheers.
I don't mind. I think I've covered quite a lot of it, and I think Amy just made it again very clear. I think it is about there is room for both. There's room for all these commissioners. The challenges are huge, and I think it is about how we are clear in their roles and their remits. And then, obviously, actually, it's really about collaboration and bringing these commissioners and public bodies together to understand how they will work together. And actually, there's potential really powerful work that they could do collaboratively. And I think that is a positive that we could look at, and actually having these commissioners working together to resolve issues that, where there is certainly intersectionality, could be hugely beneficial. And so, yeah, I think that there's room for all.
Last week, we had a few panels, and one of the witnesses suggested that the success of the Disability Commissioner Bill could jeopardise the LDAN Bill. Any thoughts on that? Obviously, you've kind of commented yourself there, Richard. You're maybe not in agreement with that, but
I think there's room for both. Mm-hmm. I think it is, and Amy just made that point about clarity of remit and roles, and I think if we get that correct, and if that works, and there's space for collaboration as well as separating who does what, and then there is that, obviously, the ability to make sure that people in contact with a system get support, then I think that they should both work.
Cheers, thanks for that. I'm going to move now on to finances, and again, similar questions from last week in terms of, you know, the sort of financial estimates. They're talking possibly £1 million. Do you think that's kind of an underestimation in terms of setting up the bill, etc.? Amy, do you have any kind of thoughts on that?
I think that the costs of ensuring that disabled people can access things on any things, that's a bit imprecise, can access services, can access the same mechanisms, and public administration that others can access, are often underestimated. So I would be wary at suggesting that this can be done cheaply. It depends what you're trying to do with this commissioner. And as I mentioned before, our support for such an office, whether for this, whether for the LDAM bill and for others, would be predicated on it actually having a point and not being tokenistic. It may be a waste of £1 million if that £1 million has no teeth. You may get better value out of spending £2 million each year in order to make sure that there's actually some impact. But the impact of that it should be seen as an investment, and there's no point in doing it if it's not seen as an investment. There's no point in just spending the money and seeing that as money gone down the drain. It needs to be seen as an investment to make sure that existing resources that are spent across health, social care, education and justice are spent more effectively and have the intended effect and the intended impact and outcomes that they should do, because at the moment they're not, and that's why the commissioner is needed. So any resource spent on this should be seen as an investment and not just spend.
Thank you.
Just going to say, as an addition to that, I apologise, I've not read the financial memorandum line by line. I've seen the top line numbers. But actually, if the commissioner's role creates greater opportunities for people with disabilities to engage more in society, to access services earlier, then that actually the economic benefit might actually outweigh the cost. And have we done any kind of assessment about the potential economic benefit of having a commissioner in supporting such a significant population to access more rights and more opportunities through education, employment and elsewhere?
Thanks for that. And obviously as well, going back to last week, there was obviously kind of one really wanted to know what your thoughts were on the concern that the funding for the new Disability Commissioner could divert money away from kind of other public policies aimed at those with disabilities. And again, I throw that out to you, but as I say, we don't want you to be tokenistic on this one, do you mean?
I don't mind coming in. Again, I think just more generally, we're all concerned about the level of public and statutory funding that's available to support services, organisations, the third sector, public bodies, and we have certainly obviously seen resources dwindle. But again, I go back to that point, and also what Amy said about if this is proper investment in a significant function that can actually deliver change and support change, then actually the benefit might outweigh the cost, and actually it might make a real positive contribution to not only the population but also to the system through creating more opportunities for people to engage in that system and to get the services that they need and the benefit that might bring both economically and socially.
Thank you. I really appreciate your comments. And MDLs before I hand back to the convener.
I echo Marie Curie and Richard Mead in terms of what your point, as in the investment. You know, if you put in X, Y, Z, and then you'll get Y come out at the end. And also the disabled people, it's very difficult for them to become economic players in the economy. Because of the lack of opportunities from a very early age, that's had a knock-on impact, and then of course that costs it much more in supporting them through social care and employment opportunities. It far outweighs what we would put in now if that investment is being used wisely, if that money is being spent with due consideration to the actual needs of these disabled people, rather than just tokenistic here's X amount, you can go and do this, and that would be the end of it. It needs to be an ongoing process, and the process also needs to be fluid, as the landscape is always changing, and especially in the light of the pandemic and the cost of living crisis. It's very important for us to recognise that anything that we do now needs to have a strong framework for room to adapt to the changing landscape of disabled people. So I absolutely agree with what the panel is saying here.
Much appreciated. Thank you. I think that's it. Hand back to the convener. Cheers.
Thank you, Marie. We'll now move on to questions from Evelyn Tweed, please.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel, and thanks for all your comments so far. I want to ask questions around the disability definition that's being used. Can you give the committee your views on using the Equality Act disability definition in the bill? And can I come to Amy first?
So we would support that. We believe it's comprehensive. We do need it. From Marie Curie's own point of view, it does include people with a terminal illness. We've done a lot of work on definitions when we've been looking at our work on a right to palliative care, which some of you may have looked at. And one of the points that came up was that you can have a definition in the legislation, but also have guidance about what that means. In terms of what different organisations' responsibilities are, as well. So there can be a definition in the legislation, but that can be clarified and expanded upon when needed as well. And I think it's important to think about how a definition would be operationalised, if you like. But from our point of view, there is value in using a definition that exists in legislation already, because as I said before, a commissioner is about putting into effect an existing legislative framework. So you also do have a question that you look at every day as a, you know, kind of as a committee and as a group of MSPs about whether that legislative framework is correct as well. That's another question. And then you've got a commissioner or a set of commissioners, as we've been discussing, who are there to make sure that that legislative framework is having the correct impact. So the legislative framework, which sits underneath what a commissioner does, is important, and therefore there is an advantage to it being an existing legal definition of disability, and we would be supportive of using the definition in the Equality Act. I hope that makes sense.
That makes sense. Does anyone else want to come in? Any other comments? No. Can you tell me what your views are on the general powers in the bill, which are, and I'll ream them out, there's quite a few of them, it's quite a broad remit, which are to promote awareness and understanding, keep law, policy and practice under review, and promote best practice and publish research. Richard, would you like to come in on that one first?
Yes, absolutely support all of those. I guess it would, and I think this has been mentioned before, obviously the ability to... I think as much teeth as possible that the commissioner could have to actually ensure that there's some redress to people's complaints or investigations that are undertaken. And I think that to me would be certainly be worth considering how you might beef up those powers to ensure that actually when there are investigations that reveal failures in the system or failure to supply, that actually there is action that must be taken, and that those organisations or services are held to account. But broadly, I think we support the general principles, but I think greater power, greater teeth would be certainly welcome as well.
Does anyone else want to come in?
I think it's important to kind of... I agree with what Richard is saying, but especially in the wording of, you know, promote understanding and awareness, I feel this could be... It could do with a bit more teeth, you know, promote and, you know, what does that really mean, like, you know, in terms of, like, what are the tangible kind of, like, actions behind that? You know, what are the boundaries of the powers that the commission has? Something that has more, it's a little bit more robust would be a positive for me, because as looking at it, it's very broad, you know, it you can stretch that meaning, and it could mean, you know, an email, or it could mean, you know, a collective like campaign from all of the charities, and yeah, you know, it. So I would appreciate a bit more robustness behind some of the wording.
I would just echo what Thomas has said there around having something a bit kind of tangible and a bit more teeth. I think we would hope that the Disability Commissioner would be a beacon of inclusive communication and accessible information. Realising that in reality is having the resources to be able to provide information in a range of formats so that they can be provided in a timely way, and it doesn't take weeks and weeks for somebody to get a format in their preferred format, medium of doing that. So, yeah, I think that's... important point there.
I'd suggest that the power to investigate, which is proposed, would be important. You know, we're all talking about teeth, and what do we mean by teeth? And I think that investigatory power, obviously limited as it is to devolved situations, would actually complement the EHRC's responsibilities extremely well, because its responsibilities are limited to reserved matters in terms of a lot of its work. So it's so I think that would be important to add to the more championing powers. You know, kind of this role is proposed to be called a commissioner, not a champion. And there have been, you know, kind of champions across government for other issues as well. I'm not saying that, you know, kind of promotion of best practice, communication and campaigning around understanding and research and review of what else goes on are not important. And I think that, you know, kind of working in a campaigning charity, that's a lot of what we do in terms of our campaigning, and it does have an impact. And so but you want a disability commissioner to have more clout than me.
Thanks for that. That's me, convener.
We'll now move on to questions from Annie Wells, who's joining us remotely. Annie.
Thank you, convener, and apologies for not being able to get on. I'm still trying to work on it, but thank you very much, panel. And I've got a question on inclusive communication. And one of the questions is, what are your thoughts on the provision for inclusive communication? And do you think it overlaps with the Equality Act duty to make reasonable adjustments? If I could ask Thomas that one first, please.
Okay. So inclusive communication, but for me, a key example would be, you know, having a BSL interpreter in the room, having the accessible laptop, not accessible laptop, a laptop in front of me with subtitles on, improving accessibility for me. That is, you know, a tangible example of inclusive communication. This looks different for many different, you know, disabilities, many different needs. I'm not saying that this is how we should do it all the time, but I think we need to be more aware and flexible to understand and provide the correct communication for those with certain needs. And that will go a long way for getting the voices in the room that will influence the Disability Commissioner.
Thanks. Thanks very much for that, Thomas. Has anyone else got anything to add to that?
We did say quite a bit about the inclusive communication question within the response to our call for views. And again, as I've stated before, provision of accessible information is crucial to enable the participation of blind and partially sighted people, and the harmful impact of not receiving information in a preferred and accessible reading format can't be underestimated. We have seen bold action already with the Social Security Scotland Act, which did enshrine and make it explicit people's right to inclusive communication as well as accessible information. And that has been a kind of beacon, a great example, I suppose, of a public body saying, having it enshrined in legislation, but then actually delivering on it as well. So I think that's, again, I've said it before, but I think the Disability Commissioner, should it be established, that would be a key role that it would have in terms of providing information in accessible formats, but also highlighting and calling into question when it's not happening. As we know already, health information, medical information isn't always provided in accessible formats, and that undermines blind and partially sighted people's right to patient confidentiality in a lot of cases as well. So there are, you know, there's a lot of reasons as to why that is so important. So, yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Just briefly.
Thank you very much for that, Kirsty.
Sorry. I just want to, just the value of specificity. I'm really pleased with myself for getting that word out without stuttering. And talking about inclusive communication specifically as one of the things that's required as a reasonable adjustment, and who ought to be doing it as well. There is what we see with palliative care in terms of health and social care services, what we see in terms of the way that disabled people are accommodated or not accommodated more often in service provision is that because terms like reasonable adjustments or the care that is required by the population are so open to interpretation, they can be interpreted within too wide an envelope that ends up missing out the people with the greatest need, and therefore including the specific term of inclusive communication. Kirsty's described the impact, the positive impact of that in the Social Security Scotland Act, and I think it would be important here to be specific.
Would anyone else like to come in on that question?
No, thanks for that as well, Amy. I don't know, Richard, if you've got anything to add.
I don't have anything specific to add, other than obviously that it's absolutely right that we get inclusive communication embedded into the role of the Disability Commissioner and the office that it will support it. But I think what I would say is just that we need to... It's kind of an extension of this. It's a little bit... It's about reach. So actually, we need to make sure that the Disability Commissioner and their office is accessible to everybody who might be benefit under that remit. So that's our hardest to reach communities, people whose perhaps language isn't English as a first language, everybody that potentially could benefit. So it's how do we make sure that reach is there so that everybody that might benefit from the Commissioner does so. And then when they do get in contact, that they have inclusive communication that allows them to articulate their challenges, concerns, their issues, and also to navigate that system and understand what the process is and how their complaint, their investigation, whatever it is progressed.
Convener, I've got one final question, if you wouldn't mind.
Yes, absolutely. Go ahead, Annie.
Thank you. This is really just about the involvement of disabled people within this bill. So what is your view of the provision in the bill to involve disabled people in the work of the Disability Commissioner? And what are the benefits and what are the challenges that we can see with this, if any? I don't know who wants to take that first. That's really strange working remotely. You can't actually see who's...
I'll jump in there. I'll say that the Disability Commissioner Bill doesn't work without the involvement of disabled people, point blank. Yeah. It's absolutely crucial that disabled people are involved in this process from the get-go. For the reasons that I mentioned earlier today, We have the lived experience, so we are aware of the impact of policies that have on our everyday lives, if it has any impact, and we know where to kind of redirect the resources where it will make the most impact. You will not get the same kind of quality of information through a hearing person, I'm sorry to say. But the challenges are, which we already kind of discussed today, is that, you know, the wide spectrum of disabled people. How do we ensure that we address the needs of such a wide spectrum through one single disability commissioner? And I think we've already discussed like having a framework in place, having like key stakeholders, inclusive communication as well. All those hard to reach communities, we need to be absolutely sure that we can reach out to those. Thank you, Richard, for mentioning that, because the BSL community is one such community where English may not be our first language. And, you know, we assist in very hard to reach communities where some people may not even have the know-how to have digital skills and access emails and websites and all the rest of it. It has to be face-to-face. So I will just go and say it's absolutely crucial that disabled people are involved from all spectrums and with key stakeholders and just basically... just get as much information, as reliable information as we can from those communities, because ultimately the Disability Commissioner Bill is for those people and therefore it should be influenced by them. No, thank you.
Anyone else?
I'm really glad. Thank you, Tomás. I don't know if anyone else wants to add to that.
Amy. I'm really glad that Thomas did speak first, because he articulated extremely well the importance as well as the challenges, but I would just add that if it's done properly, which is a challenge in itself to do it properly, if it is going to provide challenge in itself, the if these voices are all accommodated, are all involved, are all heard through the commissioner, that is going to be a challenge to the way that so many organisations in Scotland work. It's going to be a challenge to the way the Parliament works. It's going to be a challenge to the way the government works. It's going to be a challenge to the way that, you know, health boards work, that local government works as well. Mm-hmm. It's going to be challenging in education. There may be resource demands that result from that, which, you know, kind of we've got to go into this with our eyes open. And realise that the marginalisation that exists because it's difficult, it's expensive, and it's for these organisations to include people properly. So a disability commissioner is a commitment to doing things differently, or it should be. And there's no point in doing it if it's not. So it's hugely important that it's done, as Thomas described, that it's done with the full involvement of disabled people. And it might go back to the question around resource, is to make sure that that's done properly. It does need to be properly resourced. Also needs to be given time, and realise that this is going to take time. You're not going to necessarily see an impact in 6 months or 12 months, because that engagement and development with different communities and different people will take time. So I think it's just making sure that everyone has their eyes open with this.
Thank you. Annie, would anyone else like to come in on this question? I think that's done. Annie? You finished your questions.
Thank you, convener. Sorry about the technology at this end.
Thank you. Thank you so much. do the members have any other questions they wish to ask? I have just one more question, and it's just to ask, is there anybody you feel would benefit coming to the committee that we need to hear from? Amy.
I would just say, I know you've spoken to a number of disabled people's organisations, but I don't know if the committee has, rather than asking people to come in to yourselves, whether you have gone out to people where they are who might find it quite difficult to come to Edinburgh and come to the Parliament and come to a committee room and come and speak in this environment, but who have a really strong interest in the outcome of your deliberative process.
That's helpful, Amy. Thank you. And that's it. Okay, I want to thank you so much for your participation today. That brings an end to our questions, and we will now move into our private session to consider the remaining two items on our agenda. Thank you.